And now it's a special pleasure for me to introduce today's speaker. Stephen Hassan is a very old and dear friend. We grew up together as next-door neighbors on the Moonies at 2nd Street in Fresh Meadows, Queens.
Yes!
We lived fairly ordinary lives, carpooling to school together, playing hopscotch on long summer nights in the driveway, building snow forts in the winter, playing baseball on the front lawn. I couldn't catch, I never hit the ball, and I felt like a girl. Our families were close and our doors were always open. He preferred my mother's cooking and I preferred his mother's. We both ended up at Queens College in the early 1970s when the unimaginable happened. Stephen unsuspectingly joined an on-campus organization called CARP, the Collegiate Association for the Research of Principals, which turned out to be nothing more than a recruiting front group for the Unification Church, run by the Reverend Sonia Moon. Following a two-year odyssey as a Moonie in one of the most corrupt and powerful cults of that time, Stephen's exit was nothing short of dramatic. He has turned this experience into his life's work. As an internationally respected authority on cults and mind control, he has authored two books, appeared on hundreds of television and radio programs, counseled many people out of cults, and continues to do lectures and workshops. He established the Freedom of Mind Resource Center and is currently working with a number of scholars and highly regarded academicians to establish the Institute for the Study of Influence, which meshes law, ethics, psychology, and education. Please welcome Steve.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I couldn't turn down an invitation from my best friend, Monica. She also didn't say that she used to shovel food my way because her mother wanted her to eat. And when she was called, she gave me the food so I would eat it for her. Dear friends. And she tried desperately to talk me out of the Moonies when I got in at Queens College. And like most people who don't know anything about cults, she said all the wrong things, but with the best of intentions. I would just say that this audience warms my heart because this whole phenomenon is really about the unethical influence done by people to take away people's free will, their ability to think for themselves, to access their own creative gifts, talents, abilities, often isolating them from family members and friends, installing phobias in people's minds, irrational fears that terrible things will happen to them if they ever leave the group or question the leader of the particular group. And lest you think that I'm talking just about religious cults, I'm not. I'm really talking about any relationship or group that has an authoritarian feature of dependency and obedience to the authority figure. So there are business cults and therapy cults and large group awareness training cults and what else am I forgetting? Political cults that I mentioned, that religious cults, personality cults. And a key theme is deceptive recruitment. So I would challenge you on that I joined. I would say I was deceptively recruited. I would also add that people are extraordinarily vulnerable to being recruited by one of these people or one of these organizations during times of their life where they're in crisis, death of a loved one, illness, graduating, losing a job, moving to a new city, state, or country. In my case, my girlfriend dumped me. I was approached by three women at the cafeteria at Queens College who were pretending to be students, which they were not. And I had no interest in joining a group of any kind. I was not a joiner. I think I belonged to my sixth grade chorus and my Temple's basketball team. I think that was the sum total of my group involvement until the Moonies. And then within a very short period of time, I dropped out of college, quit my job, donated my bank accounts, believe that Moon and his second wife was my true parents, and my parents were just my physical parents, and was sent back to Queens College to set up this collegiate recruiting front that would basically recruit people into this club, and then they drop out of college. And I'd also challenge you that it was a politically powerful group then, because it's very politically powerful still. And lest you not know the Washington Times newspaper, has anyone here not heard of the Washington Times newspaper? One person? Okay. Well, there are two newspapers in D.C., the Washington Post and the Washington Times. And Moon, my former cult leader, owns the Washington Times and has for over 25 years. And has put over over $1 billion into this newspaper over the last 25 years. It's never made money, but it's bought him a tremendous amount of influence and power. He was crowned the Messiah in one of the Senate office buildings a few years ago. He owns the University of Connecticut at Bridgeport. He owns a gun factory in Worcester, Mass. And if you want a complete list of front groups, go to my website, freedomofmind.com, and look under the Moonies. But this is not a talk about the Moonies. This is just a talk about releasing the bonds, empowering people to think for themselves. And essentially, my message is a hopeful one. People want to be free. People want to be making their own choices. They want love. They don't want to be abused. They don't want to be manipulated. They don't want to be cut off from their family and friends. And what I've witnessed over the last three decades is some of the most virulent enemies of mine in the 70s and 80s and even 90s, people who, you know, thought I was the devil incarnate, whether they were in Scientology or the Moonies or the Hare Krishna or any group. These people are now out and talking about their own experience, and which proves that mind control is not a permanent phenomenon. And that ultimately people do get disillusioned when their leader promises things and it doesn't come to pass, or they're abused and abused and abused and abused, and then they meet people outside of the cult that are nice to them and kind to them and loving to them, and it opens up a door inside their heart that, you know, maybe there's another choice. How many people remember the Exorcist movie? 1974. When I was recruited in February of 74, and the movie came out later that year, and Moon literally bussed 300 Moonies, including me, to a theater in Manhattan to watch the Exorcist movie, and proceeded to bus us up to his estate in Tarrytown, New York, and gave a lecture about how God had made the Exorcist movie. This movie was a prophecy of what would happen to you if you left the Unification Church. And as crazy as that idea was, and the fact that I grew up Jewish, not even believing in Satan, I believed it. Totally. And I was just on YouTube the other day, and I was looking at a British entertainer named Derren Brown. Have you ever heard of Derren Brown? D-E-R-R-E-N. Go on YouTube and do a search for Derren Brown. He did the number of his programs are up on YouTube, and there's one on the nature of belief. And I was watching a demonstration where he literally hypnotized a group of people, gave them a spiritual experience, and they all converted to God. It was maybe 10 minutes long, and they said, "Yeah, now I believe." And it was just a startling demonstration of the power of hypnosis, the power of the imagination, the power of an authority figure in the right context to take and implant new beliefs or access previous beliefs that have been outgrown or whatever, and engage. So what my plan is to talk for another 20 minutes or so, and then we can do some questions and answers. So what is a destructive cult? I already kind of mentioned it. It's an authoritarian pyramid structured relationship or group that makes people dependent and obedient. And four overlapping criteria are the ones that I use, and it's based on the research and work of former military intelligence officials during the 50s the 60s who were studying Chinese communist brainwashing and Russian communists, such as Robert J. Lifton, Margaret Singer, Edgar Schein, to name a few. And my criteria is what I call the bite model of mind control, and we have copies on a whole bunch of chairs. If you came late and you don't have a copy, maybe you can get some other copies, or go to freedomofmind.com, put in B-I-T-E, and you can see it just printed off. The B stands for controlling behavior, the I stands for controlling information, the T stands for controlling people's thoughts or their thinking, and the E stands for controlling them emotionally. And so the definition of destructive mind control is any relationship or group that controls these four criteria to make a new identity that's dependent and obedient on the group leader. And so there's a laundry list of sub-variables, like controlling sleep, controlling food, making people ask permission, teaching thought-stopping techniques to block out any negative thoughts about the leader, the doctrine, or the group. Phobia installation, again, as I mentioned, the exorcist, these irrational fears that if you leave, terrible things are going to happen to you. You're going to be hit by a car, you're going to get cancer, you're going to get a heart attack. And again, what I've experienced in working with probably thousands of people now over decades all around the world is very bright, talented, educated people from good families can be recruited at a vulnerable moment of their life. And this process can be done to them. And the good news is it's reversible. It's a man-made mental illness, or I should say a human-made mental illness, and a human a solution to the problem. And back when my family rescued me, I had fallen asleep at the wheel of a Moonie fundraising van and drove into the back of a tractor trailer truck at 80 miles an hour and wound up in a hospital with a very badly broken leg. At which point I was physically away from the group and sleeping a lot, as I was sleeping 3 to 4 hours a night as a Moonie. That was part of the mind control on me. When I was lying in that hospital bed, I was just really, really, really missing my sister Thea. I have two older sisters, and Thea and I are closest in age, and she's the one person of all my family and friends who didn't say, "You're in a cult," or "You're brainwashed. You know, what's wrong with you? Wake up. Didn't you see he's an idiot? Didn't you see he's a megalomaniac?" Which just reinforced the indoctrination that Satan was in the world, that Satan works through the ones you love the most, that you have to block out all this negative stuff and stay centered with God, etc. She was the one person who just said, "I love you. I miss you. I want to know about your life. I want to know what you're enjoying doing. I want to know your friends." And even though the cult had said, "Stay away from your family," that love and that connection was there. So when I had my opening as a leader, broken leg in the hospital, I called her. And she was elated to hear from me. And she said, "You have a nephew you haven't met yet. Come and visit." And I said, "If you promise not to tell the parents and my older sister, Steph, I can arrange it." And she promised. And she later described it as one of the most agonizing ethical dilemmas of her life. She promised not to tell my family, and yet she knew I was under mind control. And she did tell my family, and they did hire some ex-Moonies, including a woman that I had actually recruited into the cult and who had escaped, to do this intervention with me. And it started involuntarily, where my father showed up and took my crutches and put it on the other side of the room and announced that we were going to talk about my involvement with the Unification Church. And my anger and my sense of betrayal and my fear, which was overwhelming. Remember the Exorcist movie? It's like really happening in my head. The following day, where I didn't call into the Moonies as prearranged and knew something was up, my father needed to get me out of the house because the Moonies were sure to call the police to come after me to get me, etc. This was 1976. And I was asking to see my mom, who was always a soft touch, and I thought I could persuade to release me. And my dad said, come on, let's go see mom. And I gladly got into the car in the back seat. My dad was driving on the LIE, missed the exit to get off for Utopia Parkway exit. And I actually thought about snapping my father's neck, because that's what I was trained to do, and to be faithful to the Father, the Messiah, this deranged, megalomaniac co-leader. Fortunately, I didn't kill my father in a moving car on the Long Island Expressway, because I was too confident that I knew what I was doing, that I was doing God's will, that I knew the divine principle, which was Moon's doctrine. And we got to the next location where the new programming was continuing, and I basically just did the ultimatum with my father. I'm not going easy, and there's going to be a lot of blood and a lot of violence. And he did the unexpected jujitsu emotional maneuver of all time. He started to weep. And my father didn't cry. I was like, whoa, what's going on here? And he said, what would you do if it was your son, your only son, met a controversial group and dropped out of college and quit his job and went, how would you feel about that? And the power of the emotion and that question, which is turns out to be one of the most pivotal releasing the bonds questions you could possibly ask, which is to ask the person to step out of their shoes and look at reality from another point of view. So when you're in a mind control call, you're only looking from the cult leader's point of view. But he accessed my real identity. He got me to step into his shoes, or at least into the future where I have a son. And I thought about all the things that he probably experienced. Of course, I believed he had been brainwashed by the communist media who was persecuting father. But I said, I'd probably be doing what you're doing right now. And I meant it. I said, what do you want me to do? He said, I just want you to talk to these people. Just listen to what they have to say and think about it. He said, just do that. Don't pull the Moonies. Don't run away. Just really think about what they have to say. And if after a few more days you want to go back to the group, I'll drive you there myself. But at least your mother and I will be able to sleep at night knowing we did the responsible thing. And it was another brilliant jujitsu emotional maneuver, which I couldn't say no to, because I was so confident that I was doing God's work on earth, that I knew the truth, that he had been brainwashed. I wanted to prove I hadn't been brainwashed. And it was just a matter of going through the motions for a few days. So I agreed. So it became voluntary at that point, which turned out to be pivotal to its success, because I don't think it would have worked if they continued to hold me against my will. And so they started teaching me about brainwashing, which is also another piece, critical piece, to undoing brainwashing and mind control, is explaining what it is in other contexts. So you're not attacking the group they're in. You're talking about, this is what the Chinese communists were doing in their thought reform programs, and you pick several other groups that do use the bite model, that you can apply the bite model to. So they were doing that. And I found myself, as they were giving me examples of their own experience, thinking better, I had better examples than those. But of course I was still not going to say anything negative, because again, I had been very, very indoctrinated. And even on the day before the final day, as they were making parallels with Adolf Hitler and Sun Myung-moon, I found myself saying, I don't care if Moon is like Hitler. I chose to follow him, and I'll follow him to the end. And then a chill went down my spine. But that's, again, how far gone I was. Being Jewish, educated about the Holocaust, saying I don't care if he's like Hitler, pretty far out stuff, but it really happened to me. And then the final day where I had my awakening moment, it was actually reading one of Moon's speeches where it was really obvious to me that he was a liar. And I allowed that thought to be conscious that Moon was a liar. And the context was he was speaking to congressmen and senators saying how no American is so foolish to be brainwashed by a Korean. And he respects Americans very much. And I had heard him lecture at least 100 times how stupid Americans were and how superior Koreans were. So it's just a direct contradiction of what he was saying and what my experience was. And at the point that I thought, what a liar, it was like a whole house of cards started to fall in my head. Because that whole identity was based on the presupposition that he was a man of God, that he was going to create peace on earth, end crime, end poverty, end war, and this idyllic kingdom of heaven would come to earth. And at the realization that he was a liar, that he was not trustworthy, and the whole thing went pum, 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 pum. And all of these experiences that I had in during 2.5 years that I had suppressed, that I had done thought stopping, that I had blocked the negative thoughts, started coming into my consciousness. And I just started crying for hours. It was devastating. So I remember telling you and other people, the time will come where you will know the truth. You will know the truth. And there the time had come, and I had my tail between my legs going, damn. Still took me 3 months before I could admit it was a cult. It's my pride. This is too much, too hard. So what do we do to help people who are in cults? You don't be angry at them, you don't blame them, you don't call them names, you don't directly accuse the group or the group leader. You engage them in a friendly, kind, curious, but concerned posture. Tell me about it. Tell me about who you were before you met the group. What did you like about the group? What makes this group so special? What makes this group different from all the other groups that say that they are the answer to all of humankind's problems? And you engage them on a human level, on a personal level. And in my second book, I talk about all kinds of questions that you can ask in a non-confrontational way that might help prod reality testing. Like, you know, what do you say to people who've left your group and no longer like it? You know, a cult member, well, you know, in a cult member's mind, there's never a legitimate reason to leave the group. So in a cult member's mind, those people are weak or stupid, or they've been brainwashed by their family or by drug, sex, and rock and roll or something. There's never a legitimate reason to leave. So you can engage them. And in particular, what's really different about 2010 than 1976 or 1986 or 1996 is the internet. It's an amazing, amazing resource. And it's also the most fertile ground for recruiting new people. It's a double-edged sword. But mind-control cultists want information control. They don't want you to talk to critics. They don't want you to talk to ex-members. They want to tell you their propaganda and only study their propaganda. So to the extent that there are former members who are writing about each group that's out there, what their actual experiences were, or using quotes from the leader's own documents. It's an incredibly powerful tool. Scientology. You've heard of it, I think? Yes. Tom Cruise, etc. They're not allowed to go to ex-member sites or critic sites. They're just not allowed to. You could say, how do you convince an intelligent, educated adult not to go to critic sites? You install phobias in their minds. You also get them to install net nanny software that blocks automatically all the critic sites. That helps too. So what I've developed instead of the deprogramming model over time is what I call a strategic interaction approach. And what that means essentially is I work with family members and friends, and I meet with them for a couple of days, and I teach them what I think the basics are, what they need to know about what is a cult, what is mind control. I often bring an ex-member of the group or a similar group along with them. And I teach them how to talk and how to think strategically to access the person's real identity and how to disempower the cult identity. So it's not just them asking their loved one, would you talk with Steve Hassan, the double? You know, or talk to an ex-member who they're programmed not to talk to. It's a matter of saying, look, if you're happy and this group is so great, share it. You know, it's that good. Maybe I'd be interested, or maybe a cousin would be interested, or whatever. There are Achilles heels, essentially. And as I said at the very beginning of this speech, people want to be free. That's my overwhelming experience. People don't like being abused and controlled and manipulated and cut off from their passions and their loves and their talents and their abilities. So to find that open door to allow the person to realize they have future possibilities where they're not going to be possessed by evil spirits, or they're not going to lose their spiritual life, or that the world economy is not going to collapse if they leave their group. How many people know Lyndon LaRouche? Political cults. They do the same bite model stuff, and they're out recruiting like crazy all over the place. But people tend to not think of it as a mind control cult for some reason. How about multi-level marketing, network marketing groups? Do you ever think of those as mind control groups? Yeah, the Amways of this world. You can make $1 million and working part-time to sell these vitamins or these food drinks or something. Check them out. They use a lot of the same kind of mind manipulation tapes and workshops. Don't hang out with dream stealers. That means anyone who tries to get you to think critically about the deceptive claims of this particular organization.
How about Jonestown?
Yeah, so Jonestown was a massacre, death of 912 people in 1978, November 18th. And we're coming up on another anniversary. 276 people were under 16, children, were forced to drink cyanide-based Kool-Aid in the jungles of Guyana. A U.S. Congressman, Leo Ryan, was assassinated. And that event actually is a pivotal event in my decision to spend more time fighting cults and mind control. Because I had never heard of the People's Temple. But when I started watching the media footage on the TV, I thought I could have done that. And it's a very, very sobering realization where you can say, you know, I could have flown a plane into the World Trade Center. That's how far down I was. Very sobering realization that has motivated me to want to teach the public, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to share this body of knowledge with you, that influence works if it's applied in a systematic way on an unsuspecting person or set of people, and that we need to protect our liberties. We need to take responsibility. We can't just say, look, they're an adult, they say they're happy. I was in the Moonies. I said I was happy. I wasn't happy. I was suppressing every negative thought and every negative feeling because it wasn't godly. I was miserable. I was asked to throw away my poetry. I was a creative writing major in college. I was asked to throw away my poetry. How could I be happy if I'm an artist throwing away my poetry? But if you asked me, and we were walking yesterday in the city on Fifth Avenue and 42nd Street, I used to lecture opposite the library for the Moonies to do introductory work lectures to get people to come to the 3-day workshop, the 7-day workshop, the 21-day workshop, the 40-day workshop, the 120-day workshop. And I was assistant director of the Unification Church at National Headquarters, which was on 4 West 43rd Street, a block from there. You know, people say, oh, cults, you don't hear about them anymore. That's because a lot of them have gained the mainstream credibility, and they have power, and they threaten to sue. And the media is not doing their job. So, with that, I think I'm going to wrap up and ask for questions. Yes? What I consider to be an evangelical Christian group or an Orthodox Jewish group, a mind control cult? My criteria is my criteria. So you look at the bite model and you ask, is the Christian group deceptively recruiting people? Is it isolating them from family and friends? Is it telling them they can't talk to ex-Christians? Or likewise with Jews, are they not allowed to talk to people who've left their particular brand of Judaism? Do they have fears that somehow they'll not be with God if they do that? It's really a very nuts and bolts kind of application for me.
If you'd like the microphone, I can walk
over. I'd like to ask Paul, who's an old dear friend of mine, to make a comment.
Yes, I'm Paul Grosswald. I'm a former Scientologist, and I came out. I came out of Scientology shortly after Steve's. I came out of Scientology shortly after Steve's first book, Combating Cult Mind Control, was published, and his book was actually very helpful to me and my family and my recovery from Scientology. So I thank you for that.
Thank you.
My question is, you have a lot of knowledge about how cults work and about how to get people out of cults. Yeah, when I look at the way our government handles terrorism and suspects of terrorism, they don't seem to have any clue what they're doing. Sticking electrodes to a person's testicles or having dogs attack them, in a prison is not a way to get somebody out of a cult. What can we do to get our government to start adopting some of these strategic intervention approaches to get people in terrorist cults to come out of it without having to, torture them or abuse them or even prosecute them, and instead of turning them into productive citizens who could actually help us to fight other terrorists?
So, good question. Anybody remember Waco and David Koresh? How do you like the FBI blaring loudspeakers all night long on people trapped in the building, or shooting their dog, or running over their cars and the other vehicles? They were doing all the wrong things. And I said that publicly. I went to my congressman. I offered, to consult. They said, don't worry, we know what we're doing. It's like so obvious that they were going to cause a lot of deaths. And Attorney General Reno at the time said, after the death and after the flames happened, we're going to do a full investigation so that we'll critique it. They still haven't contacted me about that. In fact, I gave a speech for the humanist organization at Harvard. It's on the internet, about what the government did wrong at Waco, what they should have done. And so to answer your question, I don't know, I'm trying. I wrote a piece on the Huffington Post about jihadis should be, it should be looked at as a cult influence situation. We should apply what we know. I do want to comment, one of the most hopeful, interesting things on the horizon for me about the whole terrorist, Muslim, Islamist, suicide bomber movement is an organization called the Quilliam Foundation, quilliamfoundation.org. And they're basically former jihadi recruiters and indoctrinators who are now countering the Islamist narrative. And they're literally going to mosques and debating extremists. And they know the doctrine inside and out. And it's absolutely fascinating. And I've made some overtures to say, hey people, I love what you're doing. Let me share what I've learned about the whole social psychology of influence. Let's combine forces. But I'm waiting for that to happen. But I think it is going to happen. With the fledgling Institute for the Study of Influence, we're going to have enough big name people that maybe we can also get citizens to contact their politicians and say, hey, we need to start applying knowledge of influence to help our country.
How do you inoculate people against being recruited in a cult? In other words, what might have happened in your own past that would have made it so that you didn't join the Moonies?
So what would have made it possible for me not to join the Moonies? I mean, the truth is when I came back from my first weekend workshop, they pressured me to stay for a 7-day workshop and I refused, and I came home and my parents said, where have you been? And he said, you look like you're on drugs. Have you been taking drugs? Which I said, I don't think they gave me any drugs. And my mother said, let's go talk to the rabbi. And I said, okay, set up an appointment with the rabbi. It was Ilkesh Jewish Center, for those of you from Queens. And the rabbi was clueless. He knew nothing about cults, and he knew nothing about the Moonies. What he should have said is, Steve, I don't know anything about this group, but let me give you my assurance. If this group is legitimate, it will be there next week. It will be there next month. Let's take some time and really research it. Because any group that's legitimate will stand up to scrutiny. If he had just done that and then followed up to try to find information back in 74, there really wasn't a lot on the Moonies, but there was some. That would have helped a lot. I'm actually very interested in developing curriculum for everywhere from elementary school to middle school to high school to colleges to teach critical thinking, to teach consumer awareness, to educate people about covert hypnotic techniques that are being used and promulgated. Not to frighten you, but if you go on Google and do hypnosis plus sex, you will find hundreds of websites that are training people for money on how to covertly hypnotize people to have sex with you. You know, and the knowledge is out there in the marketplace. And so for me, the ultimate way to combat this is going to be public awareness and public education. And again, not from the point of view of just frightening people, but empowering people of how to detect, you know, legitimate, healthy individuals and groups and unhealthy ones. I'm going to let Monica choose. So.
Yes, the Kabbalah Center, I think, is one of the fastest growing cults in the country. And I was wondering if you've had any experience with the Kabbalah Center in Merkwood.
I have. The Kabbalah Learning Center, HERG, is a Jewish-esque cult group. It's on my website at freewillmind.com. And think about the authoritarian pyramid structure, deceptive recruitment, and indoctrination of a new identity. That's really what you want to educate people to, not names of particular groups, because most of these groups will have front groups with different names once their name becomes well known. And again, I also have on my website assessment questions to consider before going to any workshop or program to just say, who is the leader? What is his or her credential? What's their background? Is there any controversy? And even asking the recruiter, is there any controversy? And if the cult says no controversy, and then you find out a week later there was a huge controversy about, you know, they were lying to you. And that should raise a big,
we'll take two more questions, and Steve will be here for the afternoon. There's a wonderful workshop he's presenting, so if you're interested in
listening to
more depth, for free.
1:30 to 3 o'clock.
1:30 to 3 o'clock, right here in this room. And everyone's welcome. Please join us in the afternoon. Two more questions.
When I look at your list, I'm curious about, is there any difference between your bite model and what happens in a dysfunctional family? Is a dysfunctional family a cult?
Can be. Absolutely. In fact, so the question is, what about a dysfunctional family system? And I would just tell you what Robert J. Lifton, who wrote Chloroform and the Psychology of Pluralism, he was one of the original military intelligence officials, when he was asked, what is it in humans that make them vulnerable to this? He talked about families and how we're all, you know, babies, and we look up to our parents as the ultimate authority figures who have all the answers, and then we grow up and get disillusioned when we realize our parents aren't perfect and they don't have.
I wrote an article called The Family as Cult.
Maybe you can share that. I'll put it on my website. It fits. I mean, the bottom line is we want to help teach people healthy patterns, healthy family systems, which are open, that are capable of learning, where there's accountability and responsibility and transparency of leadership.
One last question.
More of a point of information, and I want to be brief, but I was a Korean War veteran, combat Korean War veteran, and I've attended many Korean War reunions over the past 50 years. And every time I met a prisoner of war from Korea, I asked them, how was the brainwashing for the communist state? And they laughed. I know brainwashing, that's all bullshit. What did they tell me?
Okay. I